Good evening, dear brothers and sisters, all those who have joined in this online live streaming. I welcome you to one more session on the SFO formation. Today, we are going to speak on a very, very important topic, a topic which is many a times confused and many a times misunderstood, misrepresented. And so topic is very, very important, especially for all those who are going to be part of the third order. So as most of you, as I have already told you in the beginning, the SFO, as it is known, is called as, and originally the name was Order of Brothers and Sisters of Penance. This was the original name which Saint Francis had given us. So this is the name which it was known as. So this is one of the names of the order. So SFO is the official name now which has been designated. But the original name which was given by Saint Francis was Order of Brothers and Sisters of Penance. I would like to draw your attention to a very important word that Saint Francis has given. And that is, it is not given by Saint Francis, but penance. So he has called the entire Franciscan spirit, the entire Franciscan charism, the entire foundation of Franciscan life is basically based on this whole word penance. I mean, it is like the hinges of a door, like faith, hope, and charity. As the scripture tells us in this week, you might have heard of the reading in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, faith, hope, and charity. But the greatest of all is charity. So penance is a most important foundation. I mean, wherein we, so what is this penance? What exactly is the scripture trying to tell us? Or what exactly is Saint Francis? Or what exactly are we, what do we mean by penance? What do we mean by penance? So I'm going to describe this today. I'm going to try with some amount of understanding that I may have to try to explain what this penance really means. What do we mean by when we say we have to do penance? We are all called to do penance. Our Lord said, repent, for the kingdom of God is near at hand. Or he said at when the time when they when some of the disciples came and told him that the wall had collapsed and some people died. And our Lord said, do you think that they were worse than the others? Or do you think the Galileans, their blood was found mixed? So do you think they were worse? So our Lord says, unless each of you do repentance or you do penance, you will perish. So we are going to come into this word, very crucial word for the SFO or for the members of the third order. Not only for the members of the third order, but for a Christian lifestyle. Very important is to understand what is penance. So what is penance? Now, the Holy Catholic Church teaches us penance as we normally understand. Most of the people normally understand. It is, so I'm going to tell you about what is penance basically understood as. It is mostly understood. Most of the people understand penance in terms of a sacrament. All of us have heard of the sacrament of reconciliation or confession, as you call it, in very simple words. So reconciliation or confession or a sacrament of peace. So where you reconcile yourself to God and to your neighbor and to oneself, and we do confess our sins. So this is what sacrament. Another name for this sacrament is also sacrament of penance. But here we are not going to talk about this aspect. So this is one aspect where penance is known as the sacrament of reconciliation or confession. I think the stream has... Are you still getting live streaming? Okay, it is come back. Yeah, okay. So the punishment inflicted. That means voluntarily the punishment has been inflicted, taken upon. Why? For the past sins. For the past sins. So in the church, we have many, many saints who have taken upon themselves for either for their past life or either for the sake of others, they were undergoing punishment. So this is punishment inflicted. Now it can be inflicted as a canonical discipline. That means also by the church, I mean, as a form of penance. That means when the priest gives penance, that is called canonical, I mean, for so and so sins. So we're going to come into this a little later. I'm going to describe this. So this is the second way of understanding penance. Now, the third way is of the work of saints. What the saints normally do. You see, you hear of the saints, they're sleeping on beds of nails, or they're putting, you know, they're wearing hair shirt. I mean, they would wear pointed this thing within their inside of their habit. They would wear things which would pierce them. So this is the form. Or they would take, I mean, they would tie around them beds I mean, belts with filled with iron, like how we have today our belts, not that type of a belt, but a belt with which iron spikes, with iron spikes on it. So if you know that when our Lord was whipped, now it is said when our Lord was scourged, each of that, the whip which had, it had a nail attached to it. I mean, it's a private revelation. So that nail, what did it do when it would scourge and whip our Lord? Each time it would whip the flesh, it would pierce. It would pull the flesh out. That's why, I mean, with the scourging that our Lord underwent, every time his flesh was torn. I mean, he was completely pulled. I mean, each time. So you can imagine. So this was also practiced by many of the saints. So work of saints. So penance is either a sacrament, or as we understand in the most important form of term, or is the punishment inflicted for our own sins. Third is the work of saints. And fourth, which we are going to consider, it is a virtue. So very seldom do people understand penance as a virtue. Here, what Saint Francis is trying to indicate is in both this form, as a virtue. Basically, the Franciscan way is a virtue. That means to inflict upon ourselves a virtue to practice. Virtue is what you call a good habit, a good thing to do, a good habit or a good disposition. So it is not done one day, but every day I keep repeating that habit every day. So one day I do a good act and 10 days I don't do it. That is no virtue. That is not called virtue. But virtue is the practice. Like if I am giving, regularly if I am visiting Airoli, the Mother Teresa's home. So, and I'm going. And if I'm going only once in a while, once in a year, maybe on my birthday or maybe on some occasion. So that is not called as a virtue. But if I'm regularly going on a regular basis and I'm offering my services there, then that is a virtue. That is a virtue because that has become a habit. And this habit has led to means it is increasing my, so grace is coming. So this is important. So today what we are going to understand, we are not going to discuss about the sacrament of reconciliation, nor are we going to talk about the punishment, though I'm going to describe this punishment inflicted, because it has got a close connection with this virtue. And the work of the saints, as I already told you, Saint Francis. Now, I'll give an example. Whenever Saint Francis would have any thought which would tempt him against purity, what he would do, if there was a cold water, he would jump into the cold water. He would jump into the cold water, or if there were bushes of thorns, he would throw himself so that things could pierce him, so that he could never, that is mortification, so that he could never enjoy the desire. Even that thought would come, he would immediately mortify his flesh. He would immediately mortify all his desires. So that is the form of penance that Saint Francis did. I mean, a severe form of penance. So this is what we have to understand now, virtue. So what we are going to talk now, what does this virtue? So I hope we have understood these four points clearly. How penance can be described as? It can be either described as a sacrament or as a punishment inflicted upon oneself, voluntary or involuntary. Now, what do I mean by involuntary? Involuntary means Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. So all the trials, all the tribulations, all the sufferings that we undergo can be considered as a form of penance. I mean, for all our past life, for all our past sins, it can be considered as a penance, as a way. If we accept it, instead if we keep on grumbling, why I have to do this, why this is there, why that is there. If we do grumbling, then that is, does not become a form of penance. It does not act as a virtue. It does not become a virtue. So if we are grumbling, if we are murmuring, if we are complaining, it does not become a virtue. Why this pandemic? Why all these things? Why people are dying? So many questions, so many doubts, so many queries. So then that virtue is not there. So we need to understand very clearly what is this virtue that we are talking about. So how do we do penance and what is this virtue? So I'll come to the topic on virtue. Penance as a virtue. Now, there are theological virtues, as you might have heard of. Faith, hope and charity are called the theological virtues. Why they are called as theological virtues? Because their origin is from God. Having faith in ourselves is okay, but we cannot. That is human faith. But faith can come only from God. The divine faith, hope, the divine hope and the charity. So these are called as... The connection network is going, is fluctuating. Okay, so I think I'm audible now. The streaming has come back again. Yeah, so the moral virtues. So this moral virtues... which are there. So out of that, there is the temperance, there is a prudence, there is justice, and there is wisdom. So penance is among that. But penance is what is called as a supernatural virtue, supernatural moral virtue. supernatural because origin comes from God. Supernatural. Okay. Now, what does this mean? So, anyone, one thing understand, anyone who conducts sin, we all are sinners. We, everyone, each one of us. Okay. So, we commit sin. Then we do what is called as repentance. Now, please make one thing very clear. Repentance and penance is not one and the same. There is a fine line of distinction. There is a fine, though repentance is a part of the penance. Repentance can be a part of the penance, but repentance and penance are not one and the same. So repentance is a heartfelt sorrow. So whenever we conduct sin, we feel sorry, sorry for our sin. So repentance means any sin committed after our baptism, we repent for that and we turn back. So repentance, what is called a conversion, metanoia, converting from oneself, turning away from sin and turning epistrophe, that is turning towards God, turning away from sin and means from oneself and from the sin and moving towards God. That is the repentance. That means heartfelt. I feel sorry for my sin. I repent for my sin. So that is what is called as repentance. Okay. So this is what normally it happens. Now, after repentance, we also have to do reparation. Reparation. Now we need to understand these things, these terminologies, because without that, we cannot understand this virtue of penance. So, repentance, when we feel repentance, we are sorry, truly sorry for our sins. Okay, and then we do a confession and we are turned away. But that is after our baptism, when we are baptized, and further, whenever we fall into mortal sins, that is the thing. So, that is repentance. But penance goes beyond that. Penance goes beyond that. So, that is what we are going to see. Hatred of sin. Hatred of sin. Not just, you know, that, you know, just feeling sorry. But you have to detest. You have to hate it. From your heart, you have to hate the sin. You have to feel that because why? Why you have to hate sin? Why we have to hate sin? Because sin is against God. Sin is against the whole idea of God. The whole thing that we believe in God. The love of God. Sin is totally opposite and completely opposed to God. So that means penance is basically hatred. Hatred for the sin. That means as an offense against God, against the goodness of God, against all the virtues, against all. In our fraternity, I tell them, sin means what? Satan is near. Satan is near. I mean, this is just what I have just prepared as a short form. So, Satan is near. That means he's always waiting. He's waiting for us to attack us. So, basically, we have to have not only just feeling sorry. So, every time we feel sorry, again, we go back in the same sin. Again, we continue. But that is not at all penance. That is not at all penance. That is, you know, that's why there is no true penance and no true conversion. Because if the real conversion is there, then we will be like Saint Paul. If the real true conversion is there, we will turn back. I mean, repentance is not just only feeling that, you know, it's not a guilt feeling. So repentance is a totally different topic. But the heartfelt sorrow, basically heartfelt sorrow. But in penance, you have to have a hatred of sin against and offense against God, not of sin in general, but our own sin. That means what I have done against God, because sin offends God. It is a evil deed. I have to regret the mental, physical and social loss. So I don't have to feel, oh, because I'm losing some money or because my family is in problem, that's why I'm feeling sorry. Then that is not called penance at all. That is not, that is like a guilt feeling, because we are losing something. So we are feeling sorry. And then we go for confession and we come back. That is why there is no true penance. There is no true repentance. I mean, our heart is never turning to the Lord. So true repentance will lead us to penance. We have to do penance. Now, what does this penance do? Resolve to amend is not sufficient. So only just saying I will resolve. So when we say the act of contrition, we say we resolve to amend our lives to do satisfaction for our sins. But that is not enough. Hatred for the sins that we have committed over the past, that complete hating, that sin is such a big blot. That is called penance. When you really start hating sin from your heart, you detest not other people's sin, sin within us. Do not look at the log. Do not look at the speck of dust in your brother's eye when there is a own log in our own eye. So our Lord tells us. So we have to hate the sin within us, not to hate ourselves, our person, the sin which is dwelling within us, which is destroying us. That is what we need to hate. So that is what penance is. And then only we will be able to bear worthy fruits of penance. I mean, that's what saying John the Baptist in his preaching said that, you know, do worthy, repent and bear forth worthy fruits of penance. We will turn to Ezekiel. the word of God in Ezekiel chapter 28. Okay, just missed the scripture. Okay, so anyway, Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 24. And for the house of Israel, there shall be no more a briar to pick, prick, or a thorn to hurt them among all their neighbors who have treated them with contempt. So here the Lord is telling that the sin, why Israel is facing this contempt, or why they are facing this contempt, or why they are facing this disgrace, it is a form as if to bring them to repentance, to bring them to penance. This is what our Lord is trying to tell us. So now Jesus is called. Now basically, so what does, you know, what do we feel? I mean, we always hear of the penance. So we hear our Lord telling us to do penance. Each time the angel at Fatima tells penance, penance, penance. I mean, that is the first thing that the angel mentioned. When it appeared at Fatima, it gave the message of penance, penance. So daily conversion. So, and penance, that is very, very important. So now some people, they do penance, like we have seen, wearing sackcloth, putting ashes, fasting, mortification. These are all acts, worthy acts of penance. Good. But these are outward works. The conversion of the heart, interior conversion, that should lead us. That is called the true penance. I mean, penance when we are not only in our bodily, I mean, not only in the external acts. External acts are necessary. They should be visible, but also the interior acts. That is a hatred for sin. So not just feeling sorry. Anybody can feel sorry, but then again going back into the same sin. So because if we are continuing with that sin, it means we are enjoying. We are rejoicing in the pleasure of that sin. That means we do not really want to give it up. So then there is no real penance. The penance is not there. So one of the purpose of penance, I mean, the major purpose is to remind us that we owe everything to God. We owe everything. That means whatever graces. So our ongoing acts of penance should make it what? That we should be grateful for His mercy and how much we should wish. We should be thankful that every day God is merciful. Like now in this time of the pandemic, we should be thankful to God for preserving us, for not infecting us. I mean, we are not infected, or we are still, we are having a job. We are getting our food. We are thanking God. We are able to see the Eucharist online. So all these things is the grace of God. So this is also is a form of penance. I mean, when we repent and say, Lord, we are sorry for our sins, and we repent and we detest, Lord, we will not conduct these sins again. So not only a firm resolve, but also to hate the sin. That means when we think, we should not go thinking of that sin in the past, I have done this, and rejoice. If we are rejoicing, it means there is no actual penance. That means that is just we are going back to as if the pig is wallowing in its own this thing, own dirt. And the dog goes back to the vomit, as the scripture tells us. So that means there is no real penance. The penance is not there. So this penance is a virtue. So it should remind us of God's mercy. So whenever we have a penitential, we have a mindset to do penance, then it will lead us to greater attitude. That means our attitude towards God's mercy, we dislike sin, we hate sin. So we want to lose our distaste. So penance serves as an antidote. It is a remedy against all our worldliness. That means going back into the world, you know, enjoying, rejoicing. So like now, blessed are those who will mourn and weep, for they shall be comforted. This is the second beatitude. In the Gospel of Matthew, our Lord gives us the 8th beatitude. In the second beatitude, blessed are those who are mourn and weep. Now, mourn and weep for what? Then in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus says, woe to you, those who are joyful and are enjoying now, for yours shall be sorrow. Again, he goes back in Gospel of John. For now, he tells the disciples, before our Lord could go, for his passion, he addresses them. He says, for now you will have sorrow. For some time you will have sorrow, but rejoice, for the time will come when you... So that means when we have sorrow in the sense, not only, for all the pains and all the trials, but rather sorrow also for our sins. So basically to do penance means to reestablish the balance and harmony broken by sin. So all the balance which has been broken by sin between us and God, and to change our direction at the cost of sacrifice. We should be able to do any sacrifice. So a spirit of penance, a spirit of sacrifice, ongoing sorrow for our sin is very important. That means every day we should feel sorry for our sin. It is not a one day. Then it is called a virtue. Not one day I feel sorry when I go for confession and I do an act of reconciliation, I do an act of penance and I come out. And whatever the priest gives me, that much I do and it is over. No. That's what Saint Francis, if you see in the life from 1202 when his life began, right up till his death, he was weeping. That's why his eyes he started having the problems of the eye because he was continually weeping, not only for his sins, but for the sins of others, for his brothers. So he was weeping. So that is called penance. That means the dislike for sin, the hatred for sin. That is real penance. That is the real, that means we will be away. So now, what is penance? Does penance means now that should I eat karela? If by eating karela, will I be doing, or should I sleep on a floor rather than on bed, or I wear a heavy chain around my waist? So Jesus' call to penance is like the Old Testament. Old Testament where the prophets call that to wear sackcloth, ashes, fasting. As I said, these are outward signs. Okay, they remain barren or they remain sterile and false unless and until there is an interior change. Interior conversion, invisible signs, gestures. So then only the outward signs are manifesting. So I might wear a very big rosary, or I might wear a sackcloth. That really does not matter. It really does not have the time, as our Lord said, time is fulfilled. Repent, for the kingdom of God is near at hand. So after a baptism, all our sins are forgiven. And then that time, whenever we commit mortal sin, that is what we have to do. So now, whenever penance will help us greatly to overcome in maintaining our conversion so that we don't fall. So that's why, because we don't do penance, that is the reason we keep falling back into. Normally, we have some habitual sins. Every time we go on confessing, forgive me, Father, for I have sinned, I am telling lies, or I have a sin of jealousy or anger. I cannot control my anger. I cannot control my temper. Forgive me. So this is when we do penance, you and I will have a grace to not fall into the sin. Not fall into that sin. So to avoid falling into repetitively into the habitual sins that we are used to falling in, penance is the greatest antidote. That's why it is called as a virtue. It is praised as a virtue. So many may think how it is a virtue. So it's a good thing because it keeps us from becoming too proud or thinking, counting on our merits. I can overcome sin. No, I cannot overcome sin without the grace of God. So God will give me the grace. And my dear brothers and sisters, nothing but the SFO, this order, that's why it's called as an order of penance. So all those who desire to change their life, to reform their life, the third order gives you the massive opportunity to reform your life, to hate the sin. It is not going to happen overnight. It is not like the road of Saint Paul on the road, Saul on the road to Damascus, who got transformed and became Paul. No, it is a daily process. So daily we need to do penance. Daily we need to ask Lord for the grace. Unless we ask this order, that's why it is called as an order of brothers and sisters of penance. Those who desire to completely dislike, that means the past life, God has forgiven. When we do confession, when we truly repent and we are truly sorry from our heart for all our sins, not a guilt feeling, but from our heart, a true sorrow, then that point of time, it will be wiped out. Our sins will be this thing. But then there is still the temporal punishment to be paid. The eternal punishment is taken off, but the temporal punishment. And then we can still relapse back into sin. So for that, the remedy that the church offers us is penance. And that's why this order is giving us the way to follow Christ. That's why our Lord said, take up your cross and follow me. So whenever there are crosses, then we are complaining. But that cross itself is a remedy. Remember, in the desert, when the serpent bit those people, and then they began to complain. And that's why the Lord sent them serpents. And then through the fiery bronze serpent itself, whoever looked upon it. So through the poison, the antidote only was given. So similar way, through the sin, when we do penance, we are able to overcome most of our sins. So bear as in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 3, verse 8, the Word of God tells us. What does the Word of God tell us? Bear fruits that bear in repentance or penance. So exterior acts of self-discipline. So now penance as a virtue, what does it mean? So it's a special virtue. What does it mean? It helps us to labor. That means we work. Now, many of us think only we are doing our day-to-day physical work. No. In the spiritual life, there is labor. There is spiritual labor. Spiritual labor means what? When we are praying, when we are praying, prayer is not an easy thing. Many a time, if you will sit down for 10 minutes also, we will get distracted with so many things. Either the call is there, or we are looking at the mobile, or we are busy, you know, or we are yawning, or we are, you know, we are looking at so many things. So that is not called prayer. But prayer itself is a labor. So that means when we continue persevering, when we continue persevering, so the labor, so spiritual labor. So penance is a special which labors to remove, to efface sin and the consequences of sin in our life. That means sin has consequences. Every sin, there is a price to pay. Every sin has its consequence. Nobody can escape the consequence of sin. So every sin, but unless we do penance, then only we will be saved. So when we do penance, this penance helps us to remember we are miserable sinners. We are miserable sinners, and only by the grace of God, we will be able to come out of our sin, and all the consequences of sin will be wiped out from our life. So that is the time God gives us this grace. So penance is the greatest weapon. It is the greatest weapon to take up the cross and to follow our Lord. So believing that the sin is an offense against God. So it is a part of, you can call it as a part of the virtue of justice. As I told you, there are the other four cardinal virtues upon which all the virtues hang. So justice, temperance, fortitude, and prudence or wisdom. So this justice, so it is a part of, penance is a part of doing justice. Mercy is shown at the time of reconciliation, at the time of repentance, and penance acts as a sign of justice and charity. Charity towards our neighbor, towards ourselves, towards our own soul. Sometimes we don't have mercy on our own souls. So because we continue committing sin, we think it's okay. And we don't realize that we are not having mercy on our own soul. So be merciful to our own self. Be merciful to our own self. So it is a part of this. And then also the other virtues like temperance, which are exemplified when we fast, when we abstain. So only following the discipline that during Lenten time, we do fasting and abstaining, or all the Fridays of the year, we fast and we do penance. That is not enough. But this is the true penance that we hate sin. We hate sin. So just doing the exterior acts, we may be saying 10 rosaries in a day. We may be doing many, many acts of penance. All those things are meaningless because they are exterior signs. They are just the tear not your hearts. I mean, tear not your garments. As Joel, when you hear Ash Wednesday reading, you say, it says, tear not your garments, but tear your heart. Let your heart, because you should be sorry from the heart, because sin is such a grave offense against God. It directly challenges the authority, the power, the kingship, the majesty of God. So that's the reason why we have to do penance. So we have to understand this very clearly. So all our acts of mortification should be there from penance. So how do we remove these scars of sin? Since the scars do not permit us to communicate, because when there is sin in us, God cannot communicate His grace, His divine life, His divine joy, His divine peace. Why still, even after we praying the rosary, why that love, why that joy, why that peace we are not experiencing? We are not experiencing because sin is there. Sin is there. And even if we are not, if sin is there, we cannot experience the life of God. The divine power of God cannot come into our hearts. That is the reason. So what is that virtue? That virtue is the virtue of penance. So a habit, when it is well rooted and it becomes a lively one, it disposes us continually towards effacing every day to expiate our sin. So examination of conscience, that means I don't sit and examine what my husband is doing, what my wife is doing, and blaming others and pointing fingers at others and finding fault in others, but rather I blame myself. What is the sin in me? I look into myself, how sinful a person I am, and that is called penance. That when the Spirit of God really comes, it gives us that conviction that how great a sinner we are and how we need to do penance. So then we will repent, and then probably we will carry heavy stones on our head and we will cry out to the Lord. And that is the time the Lord will be merciful to us. So the mercy of God will come when we are truly sorry from our heart, when we repent from our heart. So it is a habitual attitude of the soul, not one day, as I said, towards destruction of the results of sin. So sin has its consequences. Sin has its consequences. Sin is like, you know, it gives birth. It gives birth. If you read in the gospel, if you read in the letter of St. James, chapter 1, you will find that the desire, when the desire gives birth, it gives birth to sin. And then sin gives birth. There are children. There are many, many multiple children. So all those children, one sin will give, it is not one sin, but there are added sins. There are many, many added sins. Add on. When you go to the supermarket, buy one, you get two free. So with every sin, there is a consequence to pay. So unless we do penance, we cannot come out of the sin, nor can we. We will continue falling repeatedly into sin. But penance is the sure antidote to come out of sin and to repent and to change our life so that we should do and amend our life and to make our life fruitful in the sight of God. So to resist the temptation, which leads first of all, so first we have to try to resist the temptation. But first, that's why we have to first recognize our sin. Recognize our sinful. When the Holy Spirit will come, He will remind you of all things, of righteousness and judgment, because He will convict the world of sin, because the world does not believe. Gospel of St. John chapter 16 verse 14. The word of God is very clear. What is the work of the Holy Spirit? So it will convict us. It will tell us that what is our sin. So when we realize about our sinful nature, that is the time we will understand the importance of doing penance. Others is penance, even if anybody will preach, even if our Lord, even in the time when our Lord proclaimed, the people were not ready to understand. So we have to understand, my dear brothers and sisters, what is the importance? This order gives you the great opportunity of your life. That's why many, many saints, after leading very, very sinful lives, I mean, there are many saints who became great saints. Saint Margaret of Cortona, her life was a very sinful life. But then when she came to the third order, she did great penance and she died in the order of sanctity. That means she became a great saint, and today she's venerated as a saint. So there are many n number of examples of saints who joined the third order, because I also in the previously I told you about Maria Goretti. Maria Goretti. So her murderer, the one who committed, I mean Alexander, how he repented, how he changed his life, because Maria Goretti appeared to him in prison and said, I forgive you. So because of that forgiveness, he did an act of penance, and then he lived his life in the order of sanctity by joining the third order. So this order God has given as a grace. It is not something new, not something invented by us, but 800 years it has a history given by God, and this penance is there. That's why, as I told you about the second point about those, I mean, doing penance. What type of penance? The penance, that means that they are the canonical penance, voluntary. So many saints, they would run. They would go into the desert because they did not want to be tempted in the worldly life. I mean, with all the worldly life, there were saints like Saint Anthony of the Desert. He and his sister, he was very rich. He gave up all his riches. He sold all his riches. Why? To save his soul. What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world but loses his soul? So Saint Anthony of the Desert understood this. He sold all his things. He sold his possession. These are the saints who gave the, and they started doing penance. They started doing fasting. 20 years he remained in the cave without coming out and doing penance day in and day out. So much so that the people heard of His Holiness and they began to flock to Him. So that's how we see right from the beginning of Christianity, right up till the 11th, 12th century till St. Francis came on the stage. And when this order of penance was founded. So the penance is not only for the third order, but for the entire Franciscan. It is a great virtue which God has given us as a grace. So we are able to expiate and we are able to come out from all our sins. So our attitude towards whatever sin. So as I said, we are able to overcome all our sinful. So besides protecting us from sin, the virtue of penance is also as an act of charity, because in virtue of our incorporation, we are all members. So when we weep and mourn for the sins of others, not enjoy, not rejoice, not talk about the sins of others, what do? We start gossiping, we start commenting, we start criticizing, we start finding fault, we start enjoying, we start to pick up on others. But when we do penance, penance gives us this grace that we start repenting. We start seeing our sinfulness. We look at ourselves in the mirror. We look at ourselves in the image of God. How God sees us, what He looks at us as, and how He sees us. When we look at ourselves, that is the time we begin to understand how sinful we are in the sight of God. And that is the time we begin to change our life. And that is what penance is. Penance is a dislike, a hatred. So no matter how much. So even if our sins are as the grains of the sands of the seashore, but our Lord is ready to forgive our sins. But we have to dislike the sins. So only feeling a sorry and going for confession and repenting is not going to give us the grace to completely come out. We will again fall, and we will continue in our sin. So all the saints who became saints, all the great sinners, even Saint Augustine, all those who became great saints, they did great penance. Day and night, they would cry. Their food or their drink was tears. They were crying tears. That means they were weeping. They were looking at the cross that, oh my God, how good You are. Our hearts were made for You, O Lord, and it will find rest. They were not searching for the pleasures of the world, but they were weeping. They were crying that we have offended our God. We have done so much sin. So this is the cry. This is the call for penance. So penance is something which is supernatural. That is the reason why it is called as a supernatural virtue, not an ordinary virtue, not a virtue which is to be played fool with. I mean, we may be doing, that's the reason we may be thinking, we are considering ourselves, we are elevating ourselves in the sight of others. We are thinking we are great. But let me tell you, my dear brothers and sisters, the truth is we are miserable sinners in the sight of God. Whose prayer was more pleasing? When Jesus says about the Pharisee, and the publican, the Pharisee was going and saying, Lord, I am doing this, I am fasting, and I'm doing so many things and good works. But the publican, his head is down, he's ashamed, he's humbled, and he says, forgive me, for I am not worthy. So this is the prayer. This is the prayer of repentance. In the Holy Scriptures, in the book of Daniel, again you see Daniel. Daniel is saying, Lord God, I repent for my sins and for all the sins of the people. Daniel, a humble man, a holy man. That is what which will lead us to humility. And all the foundation of the entire virtues is laid in penance. Penance is the moral virtue, which opens, especially for us, for obedience, for poverty, for chastity. If we have to be obedient, the three evangelical councils or the three councils, the gospel, the truths of the gospel, that is chastity, obedience, and poverty. How do we come to this? It is through penance. When we begin to hate our sins, when we begin to dislike, not to talk about the sins, not to discuss the sin, not to enjoy, not to gossip, not to go on slandering other people's name, not to make a mockery, not to make a fool. So this is all foolishness. It is a foolishness because we are fooling at the end ourselves. We are not fooling God. What we sow, so shall we reap. So if we sow in penance, you and I, we will reap in penance. Our God is a loving and a merciful God waiting to forgive us. But we need to do worthy. That is the reason, as I said, at Fatima, the angel said, penance, 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 penance. That means we have to do worthy works of penance, not just the external acts. Not our fasting. I fast from meat. I do this. No. The heart should be torn. The heart should weep and cry because it is offending the goodness of God, the love of God, the mercy of God, the power, the majesty of God. It is offending the loving Jesus, the loving Christ. And that is the reason why we need to do penance. Each and every moment, every thought of us, if we examine ourselves, even our thoughts, we think evil. So these are all the things that we are continually doing. So we have to examine what are we doing. Every moment, every thought, every action, every deed that we are doing is so much filled with sin. If we just examine, each of us, including myself, I examine and we find there is so much of sins in us. That is the reason we need to do penance. So penance is the virtue and the antidote. It is the power of God, so that we can reform our life and we can transform our life and we can truly become people of God, people who love God, who can say we truly love God. So the most important thing is that the forgiveness of sin and the restoration of communion with God, it requires the remission of eternal punishment. But the temporal punishment still remains. As I said, when we do a confession of sin, like now, if I break somebody's glass, only by saying sorry, I can go and say, Father, I broke somebody's glass, I did something. But I need to do repair the damage. So that punishment, the sin is forgiven, but that punishment, that means it's like repairing that glass. So that, how do I repair? That is by doing the penance. So even the venial sins, that means because it attaches us to earthly things, attachment to creatures. So now, there is another, as I was talking about the second point, voluntary and involuntary penance. So what is this voluntary and involuntary penance? So there can be made a distinction between voluntary penances and involuntary penances. So all suffering, as I said, all hardships, all trials and tribulations that come, we should accept with patience and resignation. That means we should resign ourselves to God's will, saying, may God's will be done. So out of love for God, first thing, importantly, for love for God, second thing, for sorrow for our past sins, then it can be considered involuntary penance, because this is not coming because, but it is coming by God. So these are meritorious. Taking up one's cross each day, as the Catechism of the Catholic Church teaches us, and following Jesus is the surest way of penance. Taking up our cross each day and following Jesus, That is what the third order is about. It is the following Jesus in his footsteps. So to these involuntary penances, when we add our own planned penances, that means kneeling before the Blessed Sacrament 30 minutes. I mean, kneeling, fasting, work of mercy, all these have penitential value. So every act that we do for the love of God, not just for the sake of outsiders or not just for the sake of pleasing others or just for the sake, that is not called penance. But when we do it for the love of God and for hatred for the sin and a repentant heart, then it bears great fruit and it advances on the path of eternal life. So this is what we have to understand. So eternal life can be gained. So beautiful penance. The planet Earth, basically, as the many times I have heard many scripture scholars and many of the this thing telling us that the Earth basically is a place of penance. Our real joy and home is heaven. So this is not our permanent home, because after paradise, after Adam and Eve lost paradise, the Earth is basically, Earth has been created to do penance. It has been created as a place to do penance. I mean, for repentance for man. So when Adam and Eve lost the grace of God, the beauty and the what God had prepared for them, when there was no sin, they all lost it. And then for earth is meant as a source of penance. Because of that, the ground was cursed. And then we are asked to do to labor. So this is what we have to understand. So in the spiritual life, we need to labor. So to lead a penitential life, so that we all need to have a penitential life, so that we can break our attachment to sin. Break attachment to sin. Break attachment to our sin. Each of us, all of us are great sinners. Myself, a greatest sinner among all of you. We need to break our attachment to sin. So this third order, my dear brothers and sisters, gives us the greatest opportunity of coming, doing atonement. Atonement means what? At one. At one. Being one with Christ, being one with Christ, uniting ourselves with Christ. So we thank God for all the graces and blessings that he has given us. Now, if you see our the knots or the, on the Franciscan, the cord, which is there, the symbol also, which is there, those knots signify the virtue. I mean, the chastity, poverty, evangelical counsels. So that means the priests, the Franciscan friars, take the vow of poverty, chastity, obedience. Now, we don't make a vow, but we take a profession or a promise to observe that according to our state of life, poverty, chastity, obedience. So there are five. There are five. One is poverty, chastity, obedience, and also penance is included. And, you know, detachment from sin, detachment from every earthly thing. So this is what is the five, that is the secular Franciscan knots are five knots. So when you see our cord also today, I haven't worn the tau. So in that, you will see three knots at three different places. So there are five knots also which are there. So these all have significance. They have a symbolic meaning and an importance for us to understand the Franciscan life. So my dear brothers and sisters, I thank you all for joining in this evening. May God bless us all and give us the grace to continue in our penitential life and to lead a life of penance. The SFO is a call to do penance, to change our lives. And as I told you in the beginning of this session, the SFO is known as the Order of Brothers and Sisters of Penance. All those who desire to change their life, to reform their life, the SFO offers the sure way of life through the gospel. That is what our Lord has taught us. So this rule gives us this grace.